Hi, I'm Jim Stroud, and this is my podcast. I just had the most wonderful conversation with a guest, the guest being Rachel Lyubovitzky, who is the CEO and co-founder and chairwoman of Setuply. She has served as a limited partner for both 2048 Ventures and GTM Funds. She previously founded three additional B2B technology companies, including Everything Benefits, Knowledge Sum, and Search Feed. She graduated from the Wharton Executive MBA program and earned her MA in Computer Science from Brandeis University. She's also an avid traveler, a published author, and currently resides with her family in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. Pretty la-di-da, right? I was expecting, but I got a really pleasant conversation. We had such a good time talking about artificial intelligence, technology in the workplace, so many different things. We just chatted away. It was such a great conversation. I really enjoyed talking to her, and I think that will show up. I think you will pick up on that when you listen to this podcast. So I'm going to stop talking. Stand by for a great conversation with Rachel Lyubovitzky right after this word from my sponsor. This episode of the Jim Stroud Podcast is brought to you by Source Owls. Source Owls is an online platform that brings together thousands of experienced executive recruiters with hiring managers to fill pressing human capital needs quickly and efficiently.
Are you looking to improve your recruitment results while lowering the cost per hire? Wouldn't it be great if you could name your price for each placement? Source Owls uses a breakthrough recruitment ecosystem that delivers high-quality candidates quickly and at a significant cost savings. Here's how it works. Source Owls puts you in control with its Name Your Price model. That's right, you name your price for each hire. We partner with thousands of niche recruiters across the country. Our recruiter ecosystem grows daily as we add new recruiters to the platform. You select what recruiters you want to work with and create teams for different job types. Imagine using one vendor agreement to tap into an ever-growing community of successful recruiters. These recruiters have a minimum of 5 years of experience and are eager to work on your recruiting projects. The platform is simplistically designed with talent pipeline management, so you will always know where your candidates are in the interviewing process. With 80 plus automated notifications, candidates and recruiters are updated seamlessly. The results are guaranteed, and there is no cost to post your jobs. Source Owls allows you to take control of the recruitment process. You have never encountered recruiting like this before. Go to our website and start posting your first job now, or schedule a demo with us.
To learn more about how Source Owls can produce results for you, click the link in the podcast description. Hello and welcome to the Jim Stroud Podcast. Today we have a very special guest. Special guest, tell us, who are you and what do you do?
Hey Jim, it's a pleasure to be here. My name is Rachel Lyubovitzky. I'm the CEO of Setuply.
Nice, nice. What is Setuply? Tell me a little bit about that if you would.
Setuply is a client onboarding automation platform that helps transform brand new client relationships into brand advocates by streamlining client onboarding experience.
Very nice, very nice. Now, I looked you up, of course, prior to the podcast, and I saw that you had a very illustrious career, a sort of an entrepreneurial journey. And it puts to mind a couple of things. One is when I think about your background, I think about AI and its impact on the workforce. On the workplace, how would you say AI has already impacted the workplace? And can you give me some examples maybe you've encountered with artificial intelligence in your entrepreneurial journey?
So with this latest venture, Setuply, we kind of all of us experienced this massive point when ChatGPT and other massive AI platforms became day-to-day reality. And I think it's transformed the workplace irreversibly. While you currently still have, and it's kind of fun to run into folks that are in a little bit of denial, hey, this is not here to stay, this may go away. I don't think that's what's happening. I think the point is irreversible. AI is a part of our personal and professional lives. And at this time, it is helping us do more, be more productive, grow faster, and learn faster. And I view it as an enormous sidekick that's helping move everybody forward faster.
When I first saw ChatGPT in motion in January, I had the same sensation that I had so many years ago when I saw the internet for the first time. And I've some of the first email, CompuServe, and this is really dating myself. I felt the same way when I saw it. Did you feel that way too? Like the whole world just changed when you saw it in action?
Yeah, we spent a couple of days kind of at work and at home reflecting on this is major. This is it will change how we go on vacation, how we work, how we connect with one another, how we learn and research information. At this time, when you type in, remember the times when you type in and do a search and click link one, see what they have, link two. Not anymore. You get the answer in seconds, like less than seconds. And a lot of times you don't go back to really validate and check. So there are definitely implications. They're positive and negative that we will continue to explore and learn as the time goes on.
Can you share any insights into how AI can be leveraged to improve client onboarding processes, particularly in addressing deficiencies? I know with Setuply, you do a little bit of that.
Definitely. So multiple dimensions in how that could be done. One of the obvious ones from the client perspective, and it is starting to be used across the business ecosystem, it's helping answer questions. It's basically a robotic AI that learns from the most typical questions that are being asked and helps provide answers to clients instantaneously. Much better than those hardwired sort of programs that are not self-learning. So a system that's self-learning that learns from experience and continues and gets better and better really relieves the pressure on the client success teams and also improves the job satisfaction. How satisfying is it to answer the same question over and over and over and over again? So it kind of moves them to the next plane, allows them the support teams and implementation teams to engage on a deeper level, more complex, more creatively, just as what humans do. And from the kind of back-end operational perspective, I'll give you one example, and there are so many. When you're looking to make onboarding projects more predictable, more on track, get some kind of metrics in place. Hey, onboarding should run 3 months, 6 months, however long. A lot of the times, those estimates are driven by human estimates. Hey, it will take me like 2 hours to do this. Oh no, it will take me 5 hours. It will take me 3 days. AI actually learns seeing different implementation reps implement and kind of says, hey, that task should really take this much. This is the baseline for how long this typical task should take. And that provides guidelines to the management so they can plan better, hire better, train where appropriate. It provides feedback to the clients. How long should they really be expecting for their project to take? So multiple dimensions in how AI in just one little thing like task management and learning for how long it takes to do certain things can learn and provide guidance to the leadership, to the team that's working on it, and to the clients.
I can see some of the obvious benefits of integrating AI into client onboarding. Are there any challenges that come along with that as well? If so, can you talk about those and how to overcome them?
So you have to be sort of going back to the client example, you have to be mindful, probably all of us are familiar with sort of being caught in the phone loop where you call in for some customer support and then you're caught up in the maze and you say something and the robot answers back something and then you say something else and you feel like there's no humans, there's no one there to help you. So Whereas AI is wonderful and good and great, at the end of the day, we know we have to be aware of its limitations, of the fact that it could learn wrong things, it could learn wrongly. Humans should always back it up and kind of make sure that there's no one who is lost, no one who is being led in the wrong direction. So trust, but still stay involved, because AI cannot replace humans. As awesome as it is, you have to be mindful of the fact that humans have to be able to connect with other humans. So that's on that side. And as far as, you know, again, I'll take the task example because maybe it's easier to kind of stay on the same point. You know, a lot goes into getting something done, you know, going to the post office to pick up mail. Hey, what if you run into your neighbor and have a conversation? What if there is traffic on the way? AI may not be aware and mindful of all the different things that can happen in the realm of somebody working on something. So again, we need to have humans involved. We need to constantly think of those different scenarios, just like the folks in the automotive industry are trying to train self-driving cars, all the things that can happen on the way so it could make the right decisions. It applies everywhere where AI is used, and you have to really teach it all the possible things you can think of, and then still be in the background in case something unexpected happens.
I think you are giving people a sigh of relief, because there's been a lot of chatter about, you know, AI taking the jobs away and this total destruction. I sort of look at it, and I want to get your opinion on this too, if I may. I sort of look at it as as the when the advent of the ATM went online, and there was a big PR push, marketing push about, you know, do all your banking through drive through, and you don't have to see the teller. And people are saying, oh, tellers are going to just go away, and the whole industry is going to be done. But it didn't happen. Tellers are still there. They're just doing different things. Even with AI getting online and replacing a lot of tasks, I don't see jobs going totally away. I just see them really just sort of changing. Is that how you sort of see it as well?
Definitely, definitely. If you dig in into just about any area like healthcare, you know, you can have AI help out with diagnostics, but then at the end of the day, it can't know everything. It can help with identifying personalized medicine, but every human is unique and you can't anticipate everything. So it will make lives easier, but it will, I think, force us to be even more on top of our game, to be able to ask smart questions so that we can get good answers. Because a lot of it is, it's a matter of what you're asking. You're only getting back what you know, the extent of complexity that you're going to hear back is directly related to the type of questions that you're asking. So all of us will have to be on top of our game. And I don't think that we're looking at a massive job loss. Even in something, I think one kind of obvious example early on was, oh, we're going to lose all the content writers. AI is going to be writing all the content. No more block. Everything you're reading is no longer real.
Right.
We'll be able to tell that real quick if that happens. And you're going to become resistant and stop reading that content. So you're going to have to become a lot more creative. Even if you use AI to source some of the ideas, you still have to allow your creativity to take that to the next level.
That's a good point. And I think that's one that I don't think a lot of people really focus on. I mean, you can have automation and technology make improve a phone, but it won't come up with an iPhone, you know, something new and something different. You know, it'll just keep improving what's already there to a certain point. It's interesting. Another conversation that comes up a lot around AI is ethics. You know, are there any ethical considerations you think that arise from using AI in the workplace? And so how do you navigate those as an entrepreneur?
So a lot of it's definitely a very, very active and open dialogue with multiple dimensions, such as we've seen some examples in the corporate world where AI very quickly becomes very inappropriate if you teach it the wrong things or if it learns from the wrong data set. So that could become an issue. Privacy. You know, right now, anything you say to any questions that you ask and any results that you get, how do you know there are ownership questions, copyright questions, who really owns that derivative product? What happens if there are some companies that outright forbid the usage of AI in the workplace, like something like ChatGPT, because they were afraid that, you know, you're going to feed in the last research report and say, hey, can you make it look nice? Can you put some nice headers and whatnot on it? Meanwhile, it's highly proprietary, highly sensitive information. So the privacy sensitivity of the information is a consideration. And another one is access to AI. You know, in a workplace, some folks who have access to AI who are able to use it might have an edge over those that don't. So you have the question of fairness and equality, where people don't have the same access to tools that allow them to do their job better.
Yeah, it seems like there's a great potential to make to exasperate the lower class and upper middle class and the higher echelons even so, because if they don't have access to all these different tools, they're going to just sort of be left out, you know? It's really, really concerning. And then also what you said too about copyright issues, I think that's very interesting too. I heard how someone recorded a song with some artist that was all done by AI or something. They took the artist's voice and remixed it into an original song using that artist's voice. And I thought, huh, that's interesting. That if I was a musical artist, that would be concerning for me if someone could take a sample of my voice and make new music. Or if I were Warner Brothers or Sony or some other big music company and say I owned all of the rights to Prince's music or Michael Jackson's music, you know, I could have a new Michael Jackson album out every year for the next millennia.
Yeah, you couldn't tell the difference, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So I looked at that. I said, man, that is really concerning. So I thought the only way to get around that, well, and there may be other ways, but the way I thought about it was if you somehow found a way for artists to monetize the sampling of their voices. So if someone took a sample of my voice and made a song out of it for whatever reason, then I would get maybe like a nickel or a quarter every time somebody plays it or something or uses it. And then I was making money off of the sample of my voice. Then I could see the artists embracing it more and we would see more experimentation. What do you think? You think that's the missing element of some of the AI adoption maybe, or some of the nervousness around it because there's just not a way to monetize it just yet?
I think we are at the sort of a babyhood of this new wild world, and it will remain to be seen, because one of the things is you could argue that the voice is nothing else, nothing other than, you know, sequence of sounds at a particular pitch. Can you copyright that? Is it similar to other artists? It will potentially spawn a whole new industry that is working on protecting that and building protections around that unique, like this particular sequence is your DNA of your voice. Sort of an NFTs for the sound, just like we have NFTs for the visuals. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it will spawn a lot of industries that will sort of work on protecting those rights that talented individuals, artists have before sort of AI starts to take bites out of it.
I noticed that there is a new AI company popping up every other day. And it makes me wonder, will we get to a point where everything that's been invented has been invented? At what point do you think it'll get to a point where, okay, we've invented everything we possibly can, let's just stop and further develop what we have? Or do you think that'll never happen?
I think that's what makes us humans. We probably the guy who invented the first sort of a stick to hunt the you know, cyber tooth, you know, the wild animals way back when, probably thought, hey, this is the cutting edge tools. I have this stick. This is fantastic stick.
Oh, a spear?
I don't think anybody a spear. Yeah. Or yeah, the next guy invented the spear and said, spear is like the cutting edge of all the hunting equipment there is. There's never going to be anything else. And then they invented a gun and a bow and a crossbow. I guess it's a little bit of a generational thing that we think that this is it. We cannot go any further. This is the end. But I think the fortunate thing for us is we witnessed the creation of the internet, and we witnessed the next revolution, the creation of AI. And I'm hoping we'll still be around when there's going to be further amazing things that we ourselves cannot even imagine yet.
With so much attention on AI technology, what do you think are skills that workers should be developing in light of all this? Because there's one mindset being that, okay, I really should get into technology and really learn something to do with technology because that's where everything is going. But on the other hand, if AI does it, then I would have spent all this time learning technology only for it to be designated to a robot or some sort of automation. So what are some type of skills that workers of the future should be maybe focusing on now in light of AI doing so many things?
I think we should continue to stay involved with technology. Right now, what gives a lot of people discomfort about AI is that it is, in many ways, how it drives and makes decisions is a bit of a black box. There's challenge understanding why certain outputs are produced. And so we ourselves cannot just say, hey, this is a magic box, it produces answers. You can't take that position. You really want to understand why this is happening so you can manage it. You could continue improving it. So kind of a future advice is definitely stay computer literate and stay on top of the latest technology innovations. But on the other hand, one key area where unfortunately that the COVID had taken a bit of a toll on the recent generations, it's engaging with one another. That's where we have the edge. That's where the humanity is, the communication skills, being able to share ideas to grow together. I think we absolutely owe it to ourselves to continue to, as the future generations, learn to express ourselves, learn to communicate, to share, because AI is not going to replace that. And we need that to grow as humanity in the future.
Funny you say that. I was having a conversation with someone the other day about emotional intelligence. And we went over to indeed.com and did a search on the term interpersonal, just to see how many jobs appeared in the search results with that phrase interpersonal. And it was 80,000 or so. And I was saying that that is proof of, on some level, that companies need people with high emotional intelligence across the board for all different types of jobs, because to your point, technology can only do so much. You need to do things to sort of make yourself more sensitive to your fellow humans. You know, a lot of things in business or just in the workplace come down to talking to people, managing relationships and so forth. And when we were debating it or talking about it, I said that it probably is in a company's best interest to have some sort of volunteer programs going on inside of the company as a perk or as some part of the culture of the company. Because if workers are, volunteering at a soup kitchen, giving food to the homeless, something like that, they're going to meet people they normally would not meet. And they will be serving people they probably normally wouldn't serve. And if they can do that and maintain a level of professionalism, that's going to carry over into the workplace when they're dealing with customers. What do you think about that? And what are other ways companies can encourage their workers to stay more human instead of thinking that machines are going to do everything? If that makes sense.
Totally makes sense. One of the wonderful things we did in our last venture, and we will continue in the future, it put a little bit of a stop to it because of COVID. It's a community day for the team where team members could get together and take a day off to explore specific causes that they care about. So we had some folks going to the soup kitchen. We had some folks going to the children's hospital. Others, doing other things. And it brings them together with one another so they can engage and learn more each other about each other interpersonally. They can also jointly pursue causes that are important to them, like the things that they really care about. And it's exciting to know that some of your teammates have the same ideas, care about the same causes. So it brought them closer together. It did do some social good. I hope we bring that back. I think a lot of it took a backseat as a result of COVID and us sort of being shut in and, you know, doing things like that, being remote from each other. We absolutely need to get on top of it. And there's tons of other things. We just recently, I live in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. There was our town market day and a 10K that we run. It was just so amazing to be running alongside with others and meeting your neighbors and meeting some teachers from my kids' school and meeting the folks from my gym. It was just amazing experience to engage with other people that AI, as awesome as it is not going to replace.
I like that outlook, and I hope you're correct. One last question.
Yeah, you've been so generous of your time. If you could predict what the workplace will look like, what it will be like in the future being 2 years from now, because it's changing so fast, what do you think, because of AI and technology, what do you think the workspace will be like in 2 years? I don't even go that.
Oh my gosh, we're really, really reducing the time span here. I think AI is going to be used in just about every area of the workplace. Sales, marketing, customer success, you know, legal, just organization operations. There will be specialized forms of AI that will be custom developed to meet the needs of these areas of their organization. And in fact, they would be further specialized maybe within the industry. So you'll see continued improvement on that front. It will be a fantastic tool to, you know, you could sort of talk about the kind of job that colleges are doing, and we're looking at, that's a whole other discussion, potentially a reform of our college education and the kind of knowledge, where the knowledge workers that it is producing are able to meet the needs of the modern workplace. But AI will help close the gap and will accelerate their learning practical skills and getting up to speed and really helping reduce that shortage, critical shortage of knowledge workers that we're facing in the workplace across all areas of the business.
Interesting. Interesting. Very interesting.
I like that. I'm had to touch base even a couple years to see how correct you are.
Oh, you're writing it. Yeah, this is going on record. Oh, I hope it works.
Well, I was going to say, I was going to predict that everybody has their own sort of AI. Like we have our own cell phones, and maybe we can like sort of walk into a restaurant and our AI will just tell the restaurant what we want because we eat the same thing all the time or something like that. Kind of weird.
And Jim here is lactose intolerant and he prefers a little on the salty side. So
that's
coming right up.
That's right. And speak to him in a Russian accent or something. You'll like that.
Side borscht with it, if you will.
Exactly. Very cool. I have really enjoyed talking to you. If someone wanted to get more information about you, your company, or anything else about you, how can they find you online?
So they can go to setuply.com. That's where they can find everything about us and what we do. They can also check out our LinkedIn page or our Twitter or our Instagram.
Very cool. And to make it even easier, I'll put a link in the podcast description to make it easier for everyone. Just click the link in the description and it'll go right there. Thank you so much for your time. I do appreciate you.
Thanks, Jim. It was fun. Take care.
Well, my time is up. I thank you for yours. I'll see you again real soon right here with a brand new episode of the Jim Stroud Podcast. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, feel free to reach out to me. I can be reached by email at jimstroud@jimstroud.com. And one last favor, if I may ask, please rate this podcast. 5 stars is preferred, but please comment with your honest opinion. I really appreciate that. All right.
Okay, until next time, bye-bye.